welcome. If you were here last night, welcome back. If tonight is your first night, you are very, very welcome. And a warm welcome to everyone that's joining us on live stream. Let's wave to them. I hope they're waving back at us. Okay? So we're all in this together. So how good it is that we are here. And let us stand. And we're going to sing. I think Peter is going to tell us what we're going to sing. And remember, the one rule I have is everyone sings. Don't tell me you don't know how to sing. Everyone knows how to sing. You may not sing well. That's okay. God gave you the voice. Make him listen to it. Okay? And remember, those who sing pray twice according to St. Augustine. And who doesn't like two for once? Peter.
Please open your program to page 6 for Christ in Me Arise.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good and gracious God, thank you for listening to us as we arise. Thank you for being with us as we come to the second night of our prayer of reflection. As we come on this retreat to be with each other, to walk with your Son, Jesus, and to be with one another. As we look upon prayer tonight, let our hearts and minds be open to the relationship that is prayer. And let our hearts and minds be open to any healing that needs to take place. We ask all this in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. After he had fed the people, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat and precede him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. After doing so, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When it was evening, he was there alone. Meanwhile, the boat, already a few miles offshore, was being tossed about by the waves, for the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, he came toward them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified. "It is a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. At once Jesus spoke to them, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to him in reply, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw how strong the wind was, he was becoming frightened. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand and caught Peter and said to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" After they got into the boat, the wind died down. Those who were in the boat did him homage, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. So, do I need a timekeeper or no? I don't know. I don't think he's here anyways. Oh, Nick. How you doing, buddy? Stand up. I thought you didn't come tonight. Okay. For those who were not here last night, I had a timekeeper to keep me honest. So, Nick, what do you think? You want to do it or pass it along to someone? You'll keep it. Okay. Very good. Do you have a watch? Oh, I was hoping again you didn't have a watch, but that's, you know. Okay, how about at 8 o'clock? You are to leap out of your pew and yell at the top of your lungs, "Father Tom, it's 8 o'clock. No matter how much you'll be bothering me, no matter how much you'll ruin the moment, no matter how much you are going to lose my train of thought, you must do it. Are you ready and willing?" Okay, you will do it, right? Okay, Nick. Again, if we're here at 10:30, don't blame me. Blame Nick. Okay, Nick, have a seat. Very good. Okay, we're ready to go. We have our timekeeper. So, I hope you all went out to find out more about saints if you were here last night. To all of the grouches and curmudgeons here, happy feast day. Today is the feast day of St. Jerome. So happy feast day. And I told some of you last night that Bishop Turley would be here tonight, but he can't come because there was an emergency at the Church of St. Jerome in Bridgeport. They're dedicating a new shrine to St. Jerome, and the bishop that was supposed to come couldn't come, and so they called Bishop Turley, and he went instead, so he couldn't come to help us tonight. So maybe he'll come back tomorrow. So tonight we're going to look at prayer. Again, if I went around to every one of you and said, "Give me a rating of your prayer life, 1 to 10, my guess is most of you would not give yourself a good rating because you think you don't pray enough. It's always the priests and the brothers and the sisters and the deacons. They're the ones who know how to pray. Well, I'm here to tell you, we look to you as the priests and the brothers and the sisters and the deacons. We look to you as people who teach us how to pray. So tonight we're going to look at prayer. And remember, prayer is a relationship. Prayer is a relationship. And so when we talk to God in prayer, we're talking to a friend. No different than if you pick up the phone or shoot an email to a friend or go have lunch with a friend. That's what it is. And that's why we pray, to keep that relationship going. And so let's start by looking at this gospel. This gospel is one of my favorites. We have to remember, again, when we read the scriptures and the gospels, we know how the story goes. They didn't. They were living the story. And so they were still trying to figure out who Peter was, I mean, who Jesus was. And remember, when Jesus chose these apostles, they were normal people just like us. Many of them were fishermen. And so here they are out on this boat in the middle of the night. That's nothing new for them. These were tough, tough men. These were tough men who have seen it all. And if they were afraid of this storm, could you imagine how bad that storm had to be? Did you ever see the show, The Deadliest Catch? It shows the tough life of a fisherman or a fisherwoman. And it was tough, and sometimes it's scary. So they were terrified. It was dark, the sea was really bad, and they were afraid. So it had to be really afraid. These weren't just fishermen that, you know, go out on the weekend with a six-pack and throw a line in the water. These were professional, tough men. And if they were afraid, it had to be some type of storm. So then they see this figure walking on the water. First of all, you're in this horrible storm, and you don't normally see people walking on the water in the midst of a storm towards you in the middle of the night. Imagine the scene. They were terrified, and they yelled out, "It's a ghost! It's a ghost!" Jesus says, "Don't worry, it is I." And then Peter says something that's really stupid. He says, "Well, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Peter, are you dumb? Peter, if that's a ghost who wants to do damage to you, you just gave him the perfect in. The ghost is there. This is going to be easier than I thought. Yeah, come on out here, dummy. Yeah, come on out. Well, Jesus said, "Do come," and Peter did something that I don't know if I could have done. You know what Peter did? He lifted one leg, put it over the side of the boat, stepped on water. Unbelievable. Then he did something even more incredible. He lifted the other leg. He is now standing on water in the middle of the night in the midst of a storm. And he starts walking towards Jesus. This is not supposed to happen. And as he looked to Jesus, Peter was able to walk on water. But then the humanness of Peter started. And he started to say, "I'm walking on water. This is not normal. It's in the middle of a storm, in the middle of the night. I'm scared to death." He lost sight of Jesus, and he started to sink. The minute he lost sight of Jesus, he began to sink. And he yells out, "Lord, save me." And of course, Jesus is right there to save him. Now, I do not normally disagree with Jesus, but I have to question Jesus what happened next. When Jesus said, "Peter, you of little faith," and I'd have to say, Jesus, I have to stick up for Peter. He took those steps off that boat. I think he had a lot of faith, but I'm not going to contradict Jesus. I'm just going to say, Jesus, can we give Peter a little slack? Have you ever been like Peter? Have you ever, in the storms of life, taken a step? Have you ever walked towards Jesus? And friends, we all do that in the good times and the bad times of life. As long as we walk towards Jesus, we can walk on the waters of life. Don't try it literally. I'm talking figuratively, the waters of life. Sometimes the water is nice and crystal clear, and sometimes it's rough. But if we have Jesus as our center, we can walk on water. It's when we try to do it on our own that we sink like a rock. But who is always there? Jesus. He is always there to bring us back. And so I'm going to challenge us tonight, as we look at our relationship with Jesus in prayer, to have Peter be one of our guides and to be like Peter, walking towards Jesus and letting Jesus be our center. so that we can walk on the waters of life. But sometimes we get anxious, don't we? We get anxious about things that are out of our control. We get anxious about things that we want to go this way when it goes that way. We get anxious when things happen that we don't like. And we all get anxious. It reminds me of a story, believe it or not. It was about 1997 or 8. I go into the faculty lounge at St. Rita High School, where I was the chaplain, and I saw on the faculty board the band director put up a notice. She said, "I'm looking for faculty members to chaperone the band trip during spring break to Disney World." And I'm like, whoa. So I talked to another one of my fellow Augustinians, Father Wes, and I said, "Hey, Wes, you want to go on a free trip to Disney World? The only problem is we have to go with 60 teenage boys." So we both said yes, because the band ladies were a lot of fun. So we went, and we went for spring break, and it was so much fun. The band marched through Epcot Center, marched through Disney World, and it was so much fun. But then Friday was coming, and now remember, this was before 9/11, so you didn't have to get there, you know, 3 hours before, take all your clothes off to be go through everything, okay? So what do you do with 60 teenage boys that have an 8 p.m. flight on a Friday, and you have to check out of the hotel at 11 a.m.? What do you do? So the band director said, "We're going to go to a water park." I said, "Oh." Now, I don't know if they were pretty new back then, but I had never been to one. Anyone here ever been to a water park? Anyone? They're pretty fun. And we went, and I found this thing called the Lazy River. Some of you know that, don't you? I don't know what it is, but it's this river that goes around the entire park, and you get in this big old inner tube. They gave me an extra big one. And I was just laying there floating around this whole water park. It was a wonderful day, as I was just watching all inside were all the different water slides and water rides. And there was one that caught my attention. You had to climb up 8 stories, and then you got into a cylinder tube by yourself. It closed behind you, and you looked down 8 stories below to a pool. And the water starts coming up, and at some point, the floor opens, and you are shot down 8 stories into a pool. I was fascinated by this ride. So you know what I thought we'd do tonight? We're going to go to a water park. You all with me? We're all here, and boy, do we look good in our bikinis and our Speedos, okay? We all look really good. I can tell you it's a fantasy, right? Okay? So here we are. And we're all getting in. Everyone getting a line, okay? The first floor, second floor, third floor, no problem. We're all talking, laughing. Everyone's having fun, right? But then you get to the fourth floor and the fifth floor. Then if you're like me, you're starting to say, "Oh, wow, yeah, oh, we're going up this 8 stories. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I don't know if I like this." Then we get to the sixth floor, and it's like, uh-oh. And then the seventh floor, and you can see everything and say, "Oh, my goodness." And then we finally get to the eighth story, the eighth floor, and we all get out. Now, there's over here, there's what they call the chicken gate. Do you know what the chicken gate is? That's the gate that you go down, and you have to walk down as the people are walking up. And as you're walking down, they're all clucking like a chicken at you. Because you're a chicken. So I'm standing in front of the chicken gate. No one is going down the chicken gate. Everyone, get into your cylinder. This is a big ride because there's a cylinder for each one of us. Get in. The door shuts behind you. And we're all there looking over 8 stories down into the pool. Some of you are so excited. Some of you are the ones like this, you're going to go down like this. Others are there just enjoying it, saying, wow, this is going to be fun. Then there's people like me who are screaming. I'm screaming, I'm banging, trying to get out. And I know I'm going to get out, but it's not going to be the way I got in. And so then the water starts. You're feeling it on your feet? You're feeling the water? Everyone feel the water on your feet? Now it's hitting your ankles. You're there? Are you screaming? Are you yelling? Are you laughing? The water comes up. It's moving up. It's moving up. And you know at some point that floor is going to open, but you don't know when. And the water keeps coming. Now the water is hitting your kneecaps, and the water is hitting your bathing suit, and you're screaming, yelling. Some of you are like this. I'm like, ah! And then it happens. The floor opens. We're all shot down, 8 stories, screaming, yelling, hollering, laughing, into the pool. And we loved it so much, we all get out and get right back in line and do it all over again. That's prayer. That's prayer. Prayer. Sometimes, you know, going up the 8 stories, it doesn't bother us. Then we start to think. Sometimes we want to go down the chicken gate. Sometimes we do go down the chicken gate. But we get in and we're anxious. But then when we know we did it okay, we get out of the pool and we start all over again. That's prayer. That's prayer. The anticipation, the anxiousness of doing that. When you're in that cylinder and that anticipation is there, it's like unbelievable. Now, do you know what the name of that ride was? I thought it was very appropriately named. The Flush. That's what it was called, The Flush. So we've all been on The Flush. Do you think Jesus ever got anxious? Do you think Jesus ever anticipated things? Do you ever think Jesus got scared? Do you ever think Jesus was nervous? Well, we know he was because Scripture tells us. Do you remember the Mount of Olives in the Garden of Gethsemane? After the Last Supper where he gave us the Eucharist, he goes off into this garden to pray. It's in the middle of the night. It's dark. He's scared to death. And he brought 3 of his disciples with him, and he said, just stay here and pray. He goes over and he's praying to Jesus. Jesus is praying to his Father. And he's saying, Father, I'm scared. I'm scared. Remember, Jesus was human, but he was also divine. So his humanness was coming out. He was afraid. Have you ever been afraid? You ever been scared of something? And Scripture tells us that he was sweating blood. Now, that doesn't mean blood was flying out. But the medical people tell us if someone is so anxious, someone is so afraid, someone is so scared, that droplets of blood, like on our brow when we get droplets of sweat, can occur. He goes back to the 3 disciples, and they're sleeping. You know why they're sleeping? They just had this huge meal with all this wine. It's in the middle of the night, and it's in the dark, and they're just sitting there. Of course, they're going to fall asleep. Remember, they didn't know what was coming. But Jesus did, and he said, pray that you're not put to the test. And then he goes back to pray, and he says, Father, let this cup pass from me. But what did he say next? But not my will, your will be done. Jesus was afraid. Jesus was anxious. Jesus was nervous. And so, friends, if you ever get that way, if you're ever afraid, turn to Jesus. If you're anxious, turn to Jesus. He understands it. He understands it because he was there. And so who better to go to than someone who understands us? And that's Jesus. Go to Jesus with everything. The joys of your life and the sorrows of your life and everything in between. He gets it, he understands it, and he is always with us. Always. He is always with us. When I was a sophomore at St. Rita High School, where I went to school, I was called in at the end of my freshman year by the department chair of the science department. I had biology, and then I signed up for chemistry. Well, I did horribly in biology. I don't think I got higher than a D. And she called me in, and she said, I'm sorry, you cannot take chemistry. you don't have the grades for it. And I said, well, I have to take two sciences. What am I going to do? She says, well, there is this one course that that you can take that I think you'll be okay in. And I said, okay, what's that? She said, electronic science. I said, oh. I said, well, my dad is a union electrician. So that must mean if he knows all this stuff, I know it then, right? It just kind of goes through the gene pool. I said, sign me up. And so I signed up for electronical science. And it was taught by an Augustinian priest by the name of Father Casimir Pizarro. Father Kaz, we called him. And he was one of the older friars. He kind of looked like he could fit into a horror movie. The way he was really tall, kind of sunken in, little round glasses, wore his habit with an overcoat and a fedora. Kind of looked like he'd be in a scary movie. Well, so I'm in electronics with Father Kaz. All I can say is this. If your father is a union electrician, it does not go through the gene pool. I didn't know what I was doing in that class. I am surprised I did not electrocute myself, someone else, or burn the school down. I didn't know what I was doing. And I don't think I got higher than a D in that class. I was so happy I had no more science to take after that. Fast forward about 10 or 11 years, I'm now living with Father Kaz. And we're at the dinner table one night, and I said, hey, Kaz, I said, you remember when you taught me as a sophomore at St. Rita? And Father Kaz was a man of few words. His favorite word was, yep. And I said, do you remember when you taught me? He goes, yep. I said, you know, I really didn't know what I was doing in there. Yep. And I said, I don't know how I passed. He said, well, if you tried, I passed you. Well, I must have tried because there's no way I passed. And he just smiled. 3 weeks later, Father Kaz comes to the dinner table and tells us that he had a doctor's appointment that day, and he did not get good news. He was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. It's a tough one. And we're all like, oh my goodness, Kaz, we're sorry. Oh, what are you going to do? He said, well, I'm going to do what the doctor tells me to do. And I'll go through the treatments, but, you know, I'll see what happens. So in the meantime, I'm going to keep doing what I do. He was helping out in the school with computers, and so he did that. About 2 weeks later, he comes to the dinner table. Now, again, this was a man of few words, and we couldn't shut him up. He says, I'm going to Lourdes with my family. And we're like, whoa, that's awesome. Now, he's never been out of the country, let alone go to France. And I remember someone said, Kaz, are you going to pray for a miracle? He said, no. He said, I'm going to pray. So he goes, well, when he got back, we couldn't shut this man up. He was 73 years old. I think he talked more at that dinner table than he did in the last 10 years of his life. And he was telling us what it was like to go into the healing waters, about how wonderful it was to be able to say Mass in the Basilica, to go where Saint Bernadette lived, to go and to be in the candlelight procession, the rosary procession. If you've ever been to Lourdes, the sick are the kings and the queens. They are treated like royalty. And he was in, someone wheeled him in the candlelight procession praying the rosary. And he just said, I am so happy. I am so happy. Father Kaz died 2 weeks later. Now you might say, this is a sad story. I'd say it's actually a joyful story. Do you know why Father Kaz was happy? It wasn't because he was in the souvenir shops or he was, you know, in a fancy hotel or what. You know what he was doing while he was there? He was meeting his friends, Jesus, Mary, Bernadette, and he was there with his family, and he was so happy he was able to celebrate Mass. He was able to pray the rosary with his family and with his family in heaven, Mary, Jesus, and Bernadette. And I'm sure there were quiet moments when he said, I'm going to see you all soon. Get ready. And so Father Kaz was never depressed because he knew through prayer, through a relationship with Jesus, that death is not the end. Death is a transition. It's a birth into new life and to be with Jesus and Mary and the saints forever. And the day before he died, he was confined to a lazy boy chair. He baptized his grandnephew. One of the deacons from the parish came to help and helped him do it, but he had enough strength to pour the water and say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So even on his last breaths on earth, he was being a priest. Father Kaz, I didn't learn much from him in electronics, and that was probably my fault more than his. But boy, did he teach me about prayer, and did he teach me about faith? Did he teach me about trust? That's why I want to share it with you, because he's still teaching through me to you. Friends, all of us have experienced loss. All of us have experienced illness and sickness and death. All of us. But what does our faith tell us? We're born, we live, we die. I like to say we're born, we live, we're born again. And that's when we go to Jesus. Heaven is the place everyone wants to go to, but nobody wants to make the trip, right? And I know it's sad when we lose a loved one. I'm not in any way dismissing that. I'm not. But what I'm saying is let our faith be our consolation. Let our faith be our hope. In the preface of the Mass at a funeral, or it was in the Eucharistic prayer, one of the prayers, it says that we experience, say Joe who died. Joe experienced the same death that Jesus did. May he now share the same resurrection. Isn't that what we believe? That's our faith. And I know it's tough, especially when people die young or by tragedy. We all know that. But even when somebody dies and they're 100 years old, it's still hard. I'll never forget, I was at a wake, and it was a 102-year-old woman in the casket. And this lady comes up and says, oh, was it sudden? She's 102, you know what I mean? So friends, Father Kaz can teach us. He didn't ask for the miracle. He said, I'm going to pray. But what he did then say is, if they want to give me a miracle, I'll take it. But he said, I'm going to pray. Isn't that beautiful? How do we pray? Look at how Jesus prayed. Look at how Father Kaz prayed. And friends, all of our prayers are answered. Oh, no, Father Tom, no, they're not. When I was a child, my grandmother got sick, and I prayed that she would get well, and she died. I said, oh, okay. What did you pray for? Well, I prayed that she would be healed. Okay. And she died. Okay. You know what that means? She was healed perfectly. She was healed perfectly. Your prayer was answered, just not the way you wanted it. But she was healed. She was healed perfectly. And so when I think of Father Kaz, I think of a man who taught me, not about electronics, but about prayer and about faith. And remember, when a loved one dies, you cannot lose someone when you know where they are. You cannot lose someone when you know where they are. Our loved ones, we believe. What did St. John of the Cross say? You're going to be judged on love. What did St. Augustine say? You're going to be judged on love. And so ask, when your loved ones die, you simply ask the question, did they love? Then answer the question. If they loved, if they tried to love, then they are in heaven. It's that simple. And that's not coming from me, that's coming from the saints, two doctors of the church. And all they did is paraphrase scripture. And it comes right from Jesus. So, how do you pray? I told you I'm going to give you five F's of prayer. You ready? Here come the five F's. Wait till you hear them. You ready? Who's ready? Who's bored? Okay, here they come. When you get up in the morning, what is the first body part out of bed? Your feet. There's your first F. Your feet. Your feet hit the floor. Make the sign of the cross. Jesus, thank you for waking me up. May I have the best of days praising you. And let me come back tonight fresh or tired so I can sleep and be fresh and renewed. You just prayed. What did that take, about 11 seconds? You just started your day in prayer. Now fast forward all the way to the time you go to bed. What's the last part into bed? Your feet. Unless you had a tough night, maybe you go in some other way, okay? When the feet come off the floor, make the sign of the cross. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for today. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings of today. Jesus, if I've sinned, I'm sorry. Jesus, let me sleep, be fresh and renewed, and wake up tomorrow and start all over again. What did that take, 13 seconds? What did you just do? You bookended your day in prayer. And it all has to do with your feet. Feet hit the floor, sign of the cross. Thank you, Jesus. Feet come off the floor, sign of the cross. Thank you, Jesus. Bookend your day in prayer. But what do we do throughout the day? The second F, food. Anytime you put food or drink in your mouth, think of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Say a prayer of grace if you want. But no matter what, just say, thank you, Jesus. Because see, if you're bookending your day in prayer and then you're eating and drinking all day, you're thanking Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I adore you. Whatever you want to say. When I was president and principal of St. Rita, I always knew which offices and which classrooms had the best candy dishes. And I'd be walking around, having some candy. And once there was a smart aleck kid who said, Father, you come in here every day for candy. I said, shut up, kid, I'm praying. Bookend your day in prayer with your feet, and then pray all day as you eat or drink. The second F, feet, food. The third F, you might not believe this one, but the third F is also something we do all day. The third F is also the name of a water park ride in Florida. The flush. Did he just say flush? Yes, I did. Stop and think about it. Who created our bodies? Jesus, God. Doesn't God do good things? Who's the one that designed our body? We all know what we got to do. You got to go to the bathroom, and you do it all day. When you go to the bathroom and you flush, thank you, Jesus. I had an older man once tell me, after this talk, he said, oh, Father, I have constipation. When I go, I always say, thank you, Jesus. And for those of you who are on water pills, you're going to pray throughout the night. Every time you flush, thank you, Jesus. One of the most natural things we do. Thank you, Jesus. People say, oh, Father, I have no time to do anything. I have no time to do a little spiritual reading. I have no time. I said, well, I know some time you have every day. I'll never forget that I learned that as a kid. I was at church, and there was a priest coming in to sell magazine subscriptions, Catholic magazines. And that's what he said. I still remember it 50 years later. He said, if you think you don't have time to read it, I promise you, buy this magazine subscription, leave it in one room of your house, and everyone will read it. The bathroom. And he was right. Bookend your day with your feet, pray all day with your food and drink, and pray all day as you flush. I used to stop there. It used to be the three F's of prayer, until a young lady said, Father Tom, you need to add a fourth F. I said, really, what's that? She said, Facebook. Oh, then it hit me. Facebook is now going to be any social media. Any type of social media, apps, emails, texts that you do, think of Jesus. Do you know if you do that, you won't be doing things you're not supposed to be doing? You won't be saying nasty things to people if you're thinking of Jesus. And so the fourth F is Facebook, which is every form of social media. If we always are in the presence of Jesus when we use social media, we will not in any way harm anyone. Think of that. I used to stop at the four F's until I was given this talk out in California. And a lady said, Father, there's a fifth F, especially if you live in California. I said, what's that? She said, freeway. And then, have you ever traveled by car in California? These people are crazy. There are traffic jams at 3 in the morning. I'm out there at 3 in the morning. I say, what are all you nutty people out here? Why aren't you at home in bed? Someone said to me, why aren't you home in bed? And I said, well, okay, you got me there. But they have traffic jams at 3 in the morning. How about us? How about us when a train comes and we're banging the steering wheel? How about us when there's an accident or something happens and we're all yelling, screaming? When you yell and scream and bang the steering wheel, all you do is hurt your hands. Are you going to move any faster? No. Last December 5th, if that was a Friday, I was driving from a convention in St. Louis back to Chicago down 55. Somewhere out, not, you know, maybe near Hirsch or somewhere out there, way out there. Stops. Traffic stops. And I saw there must be an accident. 4.5 hours later, the car was finally able to move. I am very proud to say, for 4.5 hours, I just sat there. I looked at emails. I had the radio on. Luckily, I just filled up with gas. I went to the bathroom. I had some food. And I'm saying, what can I do? There's absolutely nothing I can do. I am trapped by cars. And then there's a guardrail in the middle. And so I'm sure there were people that were screaming, hollering, pounding their hands. And I was sitting there. I think I prayed too. I said the rosary. Because what are you going to do? What are you going to do? I travel a lot. And in airports, I never complain. People complain, why is that? I don't want to be delayed. Hey, listen here, dummy. Do you want people who know how these planes work to do their job? If someone is flying this plane and they're telling us it's not safe to fly, why would you want to fly? And is it the poor person behind the computer's fault? All they're doing is looking at what the computer says. Why yell at them? Why be rude? And so, friends, when it comes to freeway, think of any of the motions that are out of our control. Why do we get upset about it? What good does it do? Does it get us there any faster? No. Just accept it. So, those are the five F's. Feet, food, flush Facebook and freeway. Now, I don't want 17 of you to tell me another F. I'm done. I'm stopping at 5, but I want you to get any of the 5s you want. Not 5s, any of the Fs. I'm just not going to add any more. But we can all pick the Fs. And those are moments that are out of our control, so what are we going to do about it? And, you know, what good does it do to get all flustered? If you're stranded, say, well, I got some free time. Let me pray. Let me relax. We don't relax enough. Think about it, friends. Feet, food, flush, Facebook, freeway. If you're sitting there saying, boy, that's real simplistic, good. I like it simple. It's easier for me when things are simple. Let's look at a couple of forms of prayer. The first prayer, the center of our lives, the most essential prayer in our life as Catholics, is the Eucharist. The Eucharist that we celebrate at this altar. The Eucharist is a Greek word which means thanksgiving, and it's a prayer. It is an unbelievable prayer. I love going into the dining hall at St. Rita on Mondays, and I'll say, did you go to church yesterday? Did you go to Mass yesterday? And this is some of the answers I get. Like, I'll go, no, Father, I didn't go. Why not? Well, you know, Mass is boring. I said, oh, Mass is boring. Have you ever looked in a mirror? You're boring. Huh? I said, when you go to Mass, do you sing? No. Duh. Do you participate? No. Do you listen to the readings and the homily? No. No wonder it's boring. You're boring. When you go to a football game, do you just sit there? Duh. When you go to a concert, do you just sit there? Duh. When you go to the movies, do you just sit there? Duh. No. You go there and you participate and you get involved. No wonder it's boring. I hate. Did I tell you I hate? I hate the term Sunday obligation. Now, don't be turning me into the cardinal saying I'm preaching heresy. I want to change it. You know what I want to change it to? Sunday opportunity. Sunday opportunity. Why should we be obligated to meet our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Shouldn't it be an opportunity every Wednesday to say, yes, I get to go to Mass in 4 or 5 days? See, when I think of the word obligation, I think of what all of you who are not religious have to do on April 15th. Become a religious like us. We like April 15th. Oh, it's a great, beautiful day. Look at the sunshine. See, but all of you have an obligation, don't you? And if on April 15th you don't meet your obligation, you get this. And a nice man or woman is at your door saying, you did not fulfill your obligation. We need to talk. We all know what April 15th is, right? Tax day. You have to fulfill your obligation. So why would we want to say Mass is like paying your taxes? So I want to change it to Sunday opportunity. It is my opportunity to meet my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and to have my life changed. So think about it. Come to Mass, but know it's an opportunity to meet our Lord and Savior. It's an opportunity to be with Jesus. Faith is a gift. What do you do with gifts? How do you accept gifts? You know, there's many ways we can accept gifts. We can, someone gives us a gift, we can use it. We can throw it in the back of the closet 5 years. When we clean the closet out, we give it to St. Vincent de Paul. We can re-gift the gift, or we could look for that wonderful gift receipt and return the gift and get some cash. Faith is a gift. Now, you're in church, don't lie. Has anyone here ever re-gifted? Don't be shy. Does everyone know what regifting means? That means when you get a gift and you say, I don't want this, you give it to someone else. I was the victim of a regift. I was the victim. Would you like to hear my victim story? Whether you want to hear it or not, I'm going to tell you. I was the victim. For my ordination, one of my Augustinian brothers gave me a gorgeous, beautiful, leather-bound 1992 calendar. Now, this was before you had it on computer and all that, so you had to have a paper calendar. And it really was beautiful, and it was leather-bound, and it had a place for your notebook, for business cards, calculators, pens, pencils, and a calendar. Beautiful, leather-bound 1992 calendar. There's only one problem. I was ordained in 1994. I was the victim of a regift. May I suggest that if you are going to regift a calendar, that you make sure you regift it in the correct year, or else you also will cause someone to be the victim of a regift. Now, you might think I don't like regifts. I love regifting. I love regifting. That's what faith is. I want you, that's what evangelization is. Don't just keep faith like this, me, 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 me. But faith should be you, 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 us, 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 us. That's regifting. So did you ever hear the saying, keep the faith? Did you ever hear that? Keep the faith, that's only half of it. Keep the faith and give it away. Keep the faith and give it away. That's regifting our faith. That's evangelization. That's what we're called to do. Do you know how many people live in Western Springs, in Countryside, in Indian Head Park, in LaGrange, in Hinsdale, that aren't going to church? Do you know you might be the one that God uses to bring them back? You might be the one to say, come on, bribe them with food. Bribe them with food. Say, hey, would you come to church with me and I'll take you to breakfast? Oh, really? Oh, okay, I'll come. And you know how you get, especially our parents here, you know how you get your sons or daughters who stop going to church? I can tell you something to do. Get them to come to the mission tomorrow night. This is what you say. What's coming up? Christmas, isn't it? Tell your son or daughter, I know what I want for Christmas. They're going to say, thank you, Jesus. I never know what to get you. This is what I want. Good. What is it? I want you to go to the mission with me. I want you to come to church with me for one day. Really? That's all you want? That's what I want. Do you know what? They might come. And they might come, and you might have sparked something. That's how it works, friends. That's evangelization. That's what it's all about. It's about inviting. Why did you come to this retreat? Not one of you had to be here. You know why you're here? Because you were invited. Maybe someone dragged you here. That is true. You might have been dragged. But you're here. And let Jesus take care of you. Let Jesus show you the way. But the invitation is so important. And don't get into people's faces. Do you like it when someone's pointing a finger in your face? No, then don't do it to someone else. Invitation and bribing with food is very good. Which, by the way, they have a nice reception afterwards in the family or the community room, okay? So make sure you stop in there. And just so you know, tomorrow night they're having a big one. Am I correct in saying that? And it's going to be in the Parish Center. So try to come by there tomorrow, meet someone new, have something to eat, evangelize with each other. Faith is a gift. How do you use gifts? I can remember when I was 5 years old. You know, you turn smart when you turn 7. But I was 5. My Uncle Joe, I now know he was a wealthy man. I didn't know that back then. He'd always give us a $5 bill. It's like 1970. Giving a kid a $5 bill in 1970 was like giving him a $50 bill today. And his money was always brand new. And I asked him once, Uncle Joe, your money always feels funny. It's always brand new. Why? He said, oh, I make it in the basement. I didn't laugh. I said, oh, okay. But Uncle Joe, I turned 7. Uncle Joe always gave us great gifts. I'm the 4th of 5 kids. We got great gifts from Uncle Joe. One of my favorites I still remember was a bathrobe with all the NBA insignias. As a kid, that was awesome. This is so cool. So I turned seven, I turned smart. You turn smart when you're seven. I said, Uncle Joe, we need to talk. I said, sure, what's up? I said, I'm very grateful for all the gifts you've given me my whole life, 7 years. But you seem to forget something. And he said, what's that? He said, you know, well, the five of us, we're your nieces and nephews. But remember, you're my godfather. So I just want to let you know, because I thought you'd want to know, that for 7 years I've been gypped of not getting a godson gift. I just thought you'd want to know. And he said, thanks for letting me know. I didn't sit for a week when my mother found out. She was not happy. But you know what? From that moment on, I got two gifts. Sometimes a little pain is worth the gain. Thank you, Nick. Thank you, Nick. You want something to, you have something to say? Why don't you come up here, because I can't hear you. It happens when you get old. What's up, buddy?
Well, first I have a question.
You have a question for?
Who was here yesterday?
He just said, well, here. Doing this 26 years, I've never heard this before. Okay.
Who was here yesterday? Raise your hand. Okay.
What are you going to say?
I have a question for Father Tom, and it's, what did you do at the police station yesterday when you told us that you went there?
Oh, you were supposed to forget about that. Okay, Nick, I will tell you. Now you can sit down. Unbelievable. Nick, I'm impressed. Nick, are you going to become a priest? You don't know. Well, it's not a no. It's not a no. Good question. I will tell you, now that I was just rudely interrupted at 8 o'clock, but I will answer that question because I did go to the Western Springs Police Department. Okay? But let me just finish a couple more things, and I'll get to his question, which that was pretty good. For how old are you? 10. I didn't ask him to do that. That was, wow. So, but sometimes we think we know it all. You ever fall into that trap? We all do it. We know it all. We know best. You know, there's another guy that always knew it all at times. You know who that was? St. Augustine. St. Augustine thought he knew it all. He was smart, smarter than everyone. One day he's walking along a seashore, and he's thinking of writing the book on the Holy Trinity. You know, so he's pondering, he's thinking, the Holy Trinity is a mystery, right? How do you get three people in one God, three persons in one God? And so he's thinking, pondering, he's walking along the seashore, and he sees a little boy about the size of Nick, and he's got a big hole in the sand. And he has a bucket. He's going in the ocean, taking a bucket of water, throwing it in the hole, going back and forth, back and forth. Augustine's saying, what's this kid doing? So he finally gets up to him. He says, little boy, what are you doing? He says, well, I'm emptying the ocean with my bucket into this hole. Augustine, the wise man, knows it all, says, kid, look at this ocean. Look at your bucket. Look at the little hole. You'll never do it. It's impossible. And the little boy looked right up into Augustine's eyes and said, it'll be easier for me to empty the ocean with this bucket into this hole than it will be for you to understand the mystery of the Holy Trinity. Whoa. It was the Christ child. It was the Christ child lovingly slapping Augustine in the face. See, when Jesus slaps us in the face, it's like with a feather. It just kind of gets us, but it doesn't hurt. Augustine, you're smart, but you're not that smart. You still got to trust. You still have to have faith. So don't think you know it all. When I was in the seminary, I was invited to go to Asia. And it was not a tourist trip. It was how to help us in our study of theology to go to the third world parts. We were in China. We were in Hong Kong, Taiwan, and the Philippines. And in the Philippines, we were going up in Cebu, up one of the mountains, to go to a parish where they were blessing a new first aid station. Now, their first aid station was like what we would consider a first aid box. It was, but they were so poor, that's all they had. And they were so happy. And they treated us so well. And that night, they put us up in the parish center on like straw mats. Well, the storm that came that night, I don't know if it was actually a typhoon, but it was the biggest storm I've ever been in my life. I was terrified, scared to death. I said, I'm gonna die on the mountaintop in Cebu in the Philippines. I'm gonna die. And I prayed, and I prayed, and I prayed, and I prayed, Jesus, save me, save me, save me. I didn't know what to do, I just prayed. I woke up in the morning, and it was a beautiful morning. You know how after a storm, it could be a beautiful day? And everyone's at the breakfast table, oh my goodness, I didn't sleep a wink, I did blah, blah. I said, oh yeah, I was really scared until I fell asleep. Someone said, you slept? And then it hit me. I prayed, didn't I? I didn't know what to pray for. How did Jesus answer my prayer? He put me to sleep. I slept through a typhoon. Sometimes when you don't know what to pray for, just pray. Say, Lord, I don't know what I'm praying for, but I'm praying. And let him bring you your answer. Pray your moments. Friends, pray your moments. What that means is whatever's going on, pray your moments. When I'm stuck 4.5 hours on Route 55 and there's nothing I can do, pray. When you're stuck at the airport, you're stuck behind a train, pray. What can you do? Pray your moments. I have, if you know anything about our St. Rita Shrine, we have the sad honor of many times hosting firefighters and police officers' funerals who are killed in the line of duty. We have now done 9 of them. And it's a sad honor, and it is an honor. Well, I was one of our St. Rita biggest alumni, Herbie Johnson, Captain Herbie Johnson. Some of you might know him. He was killed in the line of duty. The family asked me to preach at the funeral. I was living out at the moment at Villanova out in Philadelphia. I had a flight on Wednesday night for the Thursday morning mass. It started to snow. If you've ever been in Philadelphia, if somebody sneezes, they shut the airport down, okay? And I said, what am I gonna do? I can't miss this funeral. So then someone, one of the kids said, well, why don't you just drive? It's only 10 hours. Well, I believed him. It's like 14 hours. I don't know how he said 10. So I finally said, I have to make a decision, 3 o'clock. I decided I get in the car and I'm driving. And I'm driving fast. And I'm in Harrisburg. And I'm driving and woo, 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 woo. I get pulled over and a guy with a big hat comes. And I said, officer, I'm sorry. I thought who I was. I'm going to do the funeral of Captain Herbie Johnson. I'm sorry. He says, okay. Goes back, waits a while, comes back, gives me a ticket. I said, I really am. He said, oh, I believe you. I gave you the smallest ticket I could give, $101. And I said, I'm going to talk about you at the funeral tomorrow. And I drove away. And I was so angry. And I set the cruise control to 2 miles over the speed limit. And I was angry. And I was, I don't know what else I was saying, but I was angry. And then I started to laugh hysterically. I said, okay, Herbie, you got me. Herbie Johnson was one of the funniest men I've ever met. And no one will ever tell me otherwise. Herbie Johnson told Jesus to have that policeman stop me. I truly believe that. Herbie was taking care of me. Pray your moments. And I was laughing. Herbie was the kind of guy, let me give you an example. We're coming up to Halloween. This is Herbie Johnson. He had a broomstick in his tree. And the little kids would like say, Herbie, why do you have a witch's broom up in the tree? And one of his nephews asked him. He said, I told your aunt not to park there. He was a fun-loving guy. He loved people. And he loved me that day. That police officer did his job and slowed me down. Sometimes we need to be slowed down. And what did I get home? 12 minutes slower? See what happens, friends, with prayer? Pray your moments. When something happens, pray. Pray, 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 pray. And finish like Peter. What did Peter do? He took those steps. And he walked on water. And he was able to walk on water because Jesus was his center. Do it on your own. I give you two words. Good luck. Do it with Jesus. You don't need any luck. So, friends, that's how you pray your moments. And have the faith of Peter. And the last prayer I want to talk about is reconciliation. Reconciliation is a prayer that heals us. Confession is one of the sacraments. And I know some of you don't like this sacrament. Some of you say, oh, Father, we can skip this one. I'm going to tell you, it is one of the most misunderstood sacraments. And one of the reasons it is because people are afraid of it. And people are afraid of it because in our country, our culture, what do we say? Get to the top, step on everyone, who cares who you step on, to get there. And then you come to church and you say, well, tell your sins so you can be forgiven. When it comes to confession, it is not the sin that defines us. What defines us is that we are a child of God. And Jesus died on the cross to save us, not to let us be in the grips of pain and sin and worry. But I know some of you have been hurt. Some of you have been yelled at. Some of you have been humiliated. I know that, and I am embarrassed by it. If that is you, in the name of the church, I beg your forgiveness. I beg your forgiveness. The priest was wrong. But please don't stay away because of a dumb priest. And I mean a dumb priest. But rather, let Jesus enter your heart. If a priest ever does that to you in this day and age, yells at you, you know what you're to say? Say, Father, I'm sorry you're having a bad day. Jesus would never say to me what you just said to me. Father, have a good day. I hope it gets better. And walk out. And that priest, if he's worth anything, is going to sit there and say, what did I just do? A bishop gives faculties to a priest to function as a priest. I am a missionary of mercy named by Pope Francis, and there's 900 of us around the world that we can absolve and lift the excommunication of the reserved sins. And we were in Rome getting a course from the Pope, and there was this archbishop that was speaking to us and told this true story of an archbishop that went to confession at the Vatican. And when he was done, the archbishop said to the priest in the confessional, he said, Father, I will accept the humiliation you just gave me as a priest. But as a bishop, if I was your bishop, I would remove your faculties, meaning that you couldn't function. And that came from an archbishop. So friends, we are going to give you an opportunity tonight to experience reconciliation in a way maybe you haven't experienced it in a while. And how this works is you simply come up. There's going to be five priests stationed all around. You simply come up like you're going to communion. You say, bless me, Father, for I have sinned. How long since your last confession? And for some, I know, I'm not judging you. I'm dancing for joy that you're going to hopefully trust us. It might be 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years. And then you say your sins. Father will say a word or two of encouragement and love. He will not talk to you. It's not a time for counsel or advice. If you want that, come back on Saturday or make an appointment. Tonight is just about letting it out, and then Father will absolve you, and you will skip away. I went to the Western Springs Police Department last night, Nick. And I went in there, and there was a guy sitting behind a desk. I said, hello, I'm Father Tom. I'm over here at St. John of the Cross. And I just want you to know that there's going to be hundreds of people tomorrow skipping through Western Springs. He said, excuse me? I said, yeah, we're going to be, and Father Don is not giving out illegal drugs. He's only giving out God's love, forgiveness, and healing. Can you wait right here? So he goes out, comes to the back. Some guy comes out with a big hat. He's like, may I help you? And I said, yeah, I said who I am, and there's going to be a lot of people skipping tomorrow. He said, okay. I said, okay, good night. I got in my car, I started driving, and they followed me until they got to LaGrange, and then I could see him saying, the nutcase is out of our jurisdiction, and he waved. So for those of you who are afraid, as you are skipping through Western Springs tonight, the police are ready for you. Okay, Nick, that's what happened, okay, buddy? Very good. I couldn't be more serious. If you've been hurt, I apologize in the name of the church. But friends, this is all about letting it out. Don't be afraid. Be like Peter. Take the steps. Walk to Jesus. Walk to Jesus. Walk to Jesus. And if you're sitting there saying, I'm not good enough, you don't know what I did, Father Tom, please don't play God. Don't play God. If God wants to forgive you, he's going to forgive you. And guess what? He wants to forgive you. Don't play God. See, when you say you're not good enough, you're playing God. How dare you? How dare you play God? God will forgive you. I'm now going to tell you a story that's disgusting. Ready? When you have the stomach flu, there's only one way you're getting better. What's in here has to come out. Comes out one way. Sometimes it comes out two ways. But what do you all feel when it's done? Oh, that's confession. Let it out. Last story I'm going to tell. I was a young priest going to confession down at St. Peter's on Madison Avenue. Anyone ever been there? They have confessions all day. I go in, and I always go face to face. So I go into the office, and one of the brothers was there. I said, hello, brother, I'm here. They knew me. I said, I'm here for confession. He said, oh, Father, you got to go in the church in the box. All the priests are at a meeting. I said, I don't want to go in a box. He says, you got to go into a box. So I went in a box. And I don't know if I'm just too big or the box was small, but it was the old-style confessional, priests in the middle, one on each side, working the doors. That was the priest, you know, exercise machine. Okay, that's how they open the doors. And it smelled in there. I said, oh, my, I think somebody died in here before me. I said, oh, and there's just a little light. And then it happened. The door opened. And I could see through the little bit of light that was in there, the oldest priest I've ever seen in my life. This guy had to be 100 years old. And I said, hello, Father. I said, I'm a priest, I'm a religious, and I'm sorry for my sins. I've been a priest for 67 years. I've heard it all. God loves you. He absolved me and slammed the door. And I'm kneeling there in the smelliness. Say, did I just go to confession? Yes. What did I say? I said, I was sorry. I want to introduce you to a friend of mine. When Jesus was dying on the cross, there were two people on each side of him. The one criminal said, hey, aren't you that Jesus? Why don't you come down from that cross and, by the way, get me down too? See, because when you're crucified, all you can do is move your head. The other guy on the other side, his name was Dismas. Dismas turned his head to Jesus and to the other guy and says, you and I are getting what we deserve. This man did nothing. And he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Did you ever hear those words before? Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Did you know those words were from Dismas? And what did Jesus say? Turned his head and said, I promise you today you will be with me in paradise. In my opinion, the first confession ever heard was on the cross. And who was the first person in heaven? Someone who was being put to death, Dismas. So if you think you're worse than Dismas, then you're pretty special. But guess what, friends? You're special, but not that special that Jesus won't forgive you. That's what tonight's about. So we're going to give you this opportunity. And for all you pragmatic people, oh my goodness, look at all the people here. We'll be here all night. Not with me. Not with us. We move this along. If every one of you go with the five priests we have here, we will be done. The last person will be in like 26 minutes. That's how quickly it goes. Because all you're doing is saying it, Father giving you a word or two of love and advice, absolves you, and you skip away. You know why? Because I'm going to give the penance for everyone. You ready? Clasp your hands like this. This hurts, doesn't it? Let go. You just experienced reconciliation. Now I'm giving you your penance. Close your hand, but don't squeeze it. Close your hand. Here it is. I call it the hand penance. Ready? Move your thumb, then fingers like I am. One Our Father, one Hail Mary, one Glory Be to the Father, one act of contrition that we're going to say together, and 5 minutes of praise and thanksgiving to Jesus for loving you. That's your penance. Can we do it again, nice and loud? One Our Father, one Hail Mary, one Glory Be to the Father, one act of contrition we're going to say together, and 5 minutes of praise and thanksgiving to Jesus for loving you. It's that simple. It's that simple. Okay? It's called the hand penance. So, we're almost done. And then I'm going to invite you to come, receive the sacrament, then go get something to eat, and then skip home. But visit the tables that I have here. All this free stuff, the restless heart bands on all different colors. You may accessorize, take as many as you want. Stickers. Who doesn't like stickers of saints and sayings? They're all back there, okay? What else do we have back there? Oh, the Father Bill card. Make sure you pick that up. If you weren't here last night, you'll have to ask someone or ask me later. But pick it up, okay? Please pick up our poster of all of our seminarians. I got four of the seminarians here tonight, but the new poster's coming out next month. Guys, wave so they know who you are, okay? There they are. Okay, then the last thing, well, you can clap for them. The Augustinian scapular, the white scapular of Our Mother Good Counsel, is available for sale out in the foyer. Also available is the Augustinian cross, which is a reminder, a souvenir of our retreat. It's also available out there. Anyone who is college-aged or younger, come on up to me. You get one free. College-aged or younger, come on up right now. Don't be shy. Come on up. You're getting a free gift. Okay? For the rest of you say, well, I want one of those. Good. $3 out in the hallway, okay? And we don't make any money on them, but as I go around giving these retreats, you help me give them away, okay? And then the last thing I want you to pick up is this envelope. It has a picture of my mom and dad on it, the Ray and Millie McCarthy Charitable Fund. I don't charge when I go to a parish. I just ask we take a free will collection, okay? We're going to take it up tomorrow. If you're not going to be here tomorrow, you can give it tonight. You can drop it in the basket on Sunday, or you could do it online. It's all on here. All the money that you give goes to these guys. It costs us $41,000 a year for each one. So standing in front of you is $164,000 right there. We need to raise. I have no problem asking and begging for your money. You know why? What's the worst you can tell me? No. But if I don't ask you, the answer is no. So, I have no problem. Give what you can. Be as generous as you can. You will never hear from us. It's a one-time donation. You will never get on a mailing list. Okay? Look at these young people. You guys are great. Thank you for being here. I'll stay here because I'm going to then bless them. There you go. Thank you for being here. Now we ask God's blessing upon these crosses and upon all of you, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Good job. Get all that free stuff, okay? Very good. So, I think I'm done. Tomorrow night, we're going to have our third night. It's going to be a Mass. We always end with Mass, and the homily will be the extended talk. Tomorrow, we're going to look at the Catholic family. It's going to have something to do with an Irish harp. Is it the harp you play or the harp you drink? But that's going to be tomorrow, okay? Folks, you've been great. Thank you. thank you for being here. I hope you'll come back tomorrow. All the live stream people, thank you. I also need the live stream people to make a donation. Do it online, FatherTomMcCarthy.com. Pretty easy, okay? But thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Can I ask the priest, Father Don, can we get the priest to go where they're going to go? And remember, this is going to go really quickly, okay? Don't talk. If you come up to me and you start talking, I'm going to be so polite and say, no talking. Okay? That's for Saturday, if you want to come back, okay? So, Father Don, we have more people coming? Okay. So, who do we have here? We have Monsignor. Where's he going? Hello. You're going in the confessional? Where's Father Henry? Is he here? He will be, okay. I'm going to just stand right up here. And then, are we missing anyone? Is that everyone? Is that five? Father Bill here? My friend Father Bill didn't come? Oh, he's going to hear about this. Okay. What we're going to do, see if the other priests come. We're going to say our act of contrition. Everyone knows a different act of contrition, or they don't know it at all. So you know what we're going to do? We're going to do the confiteor we say on Sunday. We all know that. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned through my thoughts and in my words and what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, please pray for me to the Lord our God. Amen. You have now done one part of your penance. Remember, one Our Father, one Hail Mary, one Glory Be. We've just done the act of contrition and 5 minutes of praise and thanksgiving to Jesus. And the last thing I'm going to do is this. Once I forgot to take the mic off. I had to put the whole church under the seal of confession. Okay, Father Henry, where are you going? Father Henry's going to be over there in the corner. I'll be right here. Father Don will be right there. Monsignor will be in the confessional. And if anyone else shows up, we'll put him somewhere, okay? This will not take long. Thank you for being here. Peter is going to lead us in a beautiful song. And you can sing the song, but the minute the song starts, you may start coming up to confession. Just give people a little bit of space, okay? God bless you all. Thank you for being here. We'll see you tomorrow.
Please rise and join in singing from page 7 of our program, Amazing Grace.